I was a senior at Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee, 1959-1960. So the sit-in movement started in February of 1960 in Nashville. And, you know, I went on one march, but I wasn't, you know, that involved because I was a senior and I wanted to get out of the South. However, I ended up working at a place called Highlander Folk School. And Highlander was a school for social issues and social problems. And so I, Highlander did a summer camp the summer of 60. And it was quite unusual in the state of Tennessee because it brought together poor whites, Latinos, whites from New England up north, and black people, black kids, all in a camp. And all the counselors were different, you know, ethnic groups and what have you, which, of course, was illegal at the time in the state of Tennessee. And so I worked that summer at Highlander, and then I was hired to come back in the fall. And so I worked at Highlander from the fall of 1960 until the spring of 1961 when I moved to New York. I had spent the spring of 1959 on exchange at San Diego State College, at, which was called that time, and began hanging out at coffee shops. And that was my introduction to folk music, as it were. And so when I came back, I wanted a guitar. And so I got a guitar. And so I started learning songs and playing guitar and what have you. And then in the spring of 1960, when the sit-in movement started, a guy was working at Highlander, and he came to Nashville, Guy Carawan, and so and taught We Shall Overcome. And so that's when I met Guy. And so Guy certainly helped me learn a lot more, guitar. And then it just so happened that an exchange student from Pomona was at Fisk that semester named Candy Anderson. And that's how Guy met Candy. And they eventually married. And so it was through Guy that I got to Highlander that summer. And then I came back in the fall and worked in the office. And then when Guy was away, I would do the music at workshops at Highlander. Highlander was called together in the spring of 1960. Students who had been involved in sit-ins around the South and brought them together for the first time. And it was out of that gathering that eventually SNCC was organized, because that was the first time a lot of them had met each other. And so they decided to meet again. And so that's how SNCC was formed. So Highlander has been hugely, hugely influential, and was an important influence on, you know, you know, on my life and certainly my music, you know, during that time.
Julius Lester offers his thoughts on his children's book, To Be a Slave.
What's been absent from Western culture has been a black perspective on that culture. The book I did after Lookout Whitey was To Be a Slave. And To Be a Slave is, this is how the slave looked at being a slave. What we'd been getting was the slaveholder's point of view. Well, this is how slaves looked at it.
Thank you. meetings, the parties, and the holidays did not make being a slave pleasurable. Nothing could do that. But whatever pleasure the slave was able to provide for himself was a remarkable testimony to the ability to retain humanity under the most inhuman conditions. One of the more fascinating recorded stories of one who could be considered a good slave is the story of Josiah Henson. He was born a slave and grew up believing that while slavery was wrong, as a slave he had a responsibility to do his best work. During his early life, he constantly courted his owner's favor.
At 15 years of age, there were few who could compete with me in work or sport. I was as lively as a young buck and running over with animal spirits. I could run faster, wrestle better, and jump higher than anybody about me. And at an evening shakedown in our own or a neighbor's kitchen, my feet became absolutely invisible from the rate at which they moved. All this caused my master and my fellow slaves to look upon me as a wonderful, smart fellow and prophesy the great things I should do when I became a man. My vanity became vastly inflamed, and I fully coincided in their opinion. Julius Caesar never aspired and plotted for the imperial crown more ambitiously than did I to out-hoe, out-reap, out-husk, out-dance, out-everything every competitor. And from all I can learn, he never enjoyed his triumph half as much. One word of commendation from the petty despot who ruled over us would set me up for a month.
Henson eventually raised himself to be superintendent of the farm work and then overseer. In actual fact, he ran the entire plantation, and his owner collected the profit. Yet Henson was proud of himself and proud to be able to provide such valuable service to his owner.
I retained the especial favor of my master, who was not displeased either with saving the expense of a large salary for a white superintendent or with the superior crops I was able to raise for him. I will not deny that I used his property more freely than he would have done himself in supplying his people with better food, but if I cheated him in this way, in small matters, it was unequivocally for his own benefit in more important ones, and I accounted with the strictest honesty for every dollar I received in the sale of the property entrusted to me. It was my duty to be faithful to him in the position in which he placed me, and I can boldly declare before God and man that I was so. I forgave him the blows and injuries he had inflicted on me in childhood and youth, and was proud of the favor he now showed me, and of the character and reputation I had earned by strenuous and persevering efforts.
Despite Henson's skillful management of the plantation, the owner dissipated the profits and eventually found himself in the position where all of his slaves were going to be auctioned off to pay his debts. He came to Henson and asked him to take all the slaves to Kentucky, where he had a brother. He would follow in a few months. It was remarkable that a white slave owner would ask a black slave to be responsible for other slaves on a journey of 1,000 miles. It was even more remarkable that Henson discharged the responsibility.
My heart was aroused in view of the importance of my responsibility. In heart and soul, I became identified with my master's project of running off his Negroes.
But a crisis developed while going down the Ohio River.
On passing along the Ohio shore, we were repeatedly told by persons conversing with us that we were no longer slaves but free men if we chose to be so. At Cincinnati especially, crowds of colored people gathered round us and insisted on our remaining with them. They told us we were fools to think of going on and surrendering ourselves up to a new owner, that now we could be our own masters and put ourselves out of all reach of pursuit. I saw the people under me were getting much excited. Divided counsels and signs of insubordination began to manifest themselves. I began, too, to feel my own resolution giving way. Freedom had ever been an object of my ambition, though no other means of obtaining it had occurred to me but purchasing myself. I had never dreamed of running away. I had a sentiment of honor on the subject. The duties of the slave to his master as appointed over him in the Lord, I had ever heard urged by ministers and religious men. It seemed like outright stealing. Strange as it may seem, I really felt it then. Entrancing as the idea was that the coast was clear for a run for freedom, that I might liberate my companions, might carry off my wife and children and someday own a house and land and be no longer despised and abused, still my notions of right were against it. I had promised my master to take his property to Kentucky and deposit it with his brother Amos. Pride, too, came in to confirm me. I had undertaken a great thing. My vanity had been flattered all along the road by hearing myself praised. I thought it would be a feather in my cap to carry it through thoroughly, and had often painted the scene in my imagination of the final surrender of my charge to Master Amos, and the immense admiration and respect with which he would regard me. Under the influence of these impressions, and seeing that the allurements of the crowd were producing a manifest effect, I sternly assumed the captain and ordered the boat to be pushed off into the stream. A shower of curses followed me from the shore, but the Negroes under me, accustomed to obey and ignorant of the advantages of liberty, offered no resistance to my command.
It should be added, however, that Henson goes on to say, "My soul has been pierced with bitter anguish at the thought of having been thus instrumental in consigning to the infernal bondage of slavery so many of my fellow beings. And most significantly, I knew not that the title deed of the slave owner is robbery and outrage." Josiah Henson was one who totally accepted the slave owner's point of view. When he first began to realize that he should be free, he thought that the only correct manner of getting that freedom was to buy himself. He so accepted the slave owner's ideas that he equated running away with stealing himself. Eventually, Henson did make up his mind that it was all right to steal himself, and he escaped to Canada with his family. This did not occur, however, until after he had purchased his freedom, and his master had not only not freed him, but had tried to sell him to another slave owner. Henson did redeem himself, however, by returning south twice to lead slaves out, and he was further instrumental in bringing 118 slaves to Canada. The field slaves were not exposed to the slave owner's ideas as much as the house servant. They had little contact with the slave owner, and many of them lived and died without having once set foot inside the slave owner's house. Thus, the field slaves were able to create their own world within the plantation world, and from it they waged an everyday struggle against their enslavement. Their interests were simple: to do as little work as possible and get as few whippings as possible. While this was never possible on a large scale, they had various tricks which they used to make the slave owner's life a little less easy. The most common was to appear to be the dumb, stupid animal that he knew his owner thought he was. It was to his advantage to appear ignorant, and the more ignorant he appeared to be, the less work he would have to do. Any sloppy work that he did would be accepted as all that he was capable of doing. The field slave took advantage of his alleged inferiority. One prominent Southern physician, Dr. Samuel W. Cartwright of the University of Louisiana, was so taken in by the slave's duplicity that he wrote a lengthy essay describing various diseases that were peculiar to the Negro. The descriptions are good indications of the ways in which the slaves fought against their enslavement.
Diesthesia Ethiopica. From the careless movements of the individuals affected with this complaint, they are apt to do much mischief, which appears as if intentional, but is mostly owing to the stupidness of mind and insensibility of the nerves induced by the disease. Thus they break, waste, and destroy everything they handle, abuse horses and cattle, tear, burn, or rend their own clothing. They wander about at night and keep in a half-nodding state by day. They slight their work, cut up corn, cane, cotton, and tobacco when hoeing it. They raise disturbances with their overseers. When driven to labor by the compulsive power of the white man, he performs the task assigned to him in a headlong, careless manner, treading down with his feet or cutting with his hoe the plants he has put to cultivate, breaking the tools he works with, and spoiling everything he touches that can be injured by careless handling. Hence the overseers call it rascality, supposing that the mischief is intentionally done.
The overseers called it rascality. More accurately, it could be called sabotage. It was deliberate on the part of the slaves, for it was obvious to them that their lives did not change if there was a good cotton crop or a bad one. If they worked hard, they remained slaves. If they sabotaged the plantation work as much as possible, they remained slaves. And the latter was easier and more enjoyable.
"The women on a plantation," said one extensive Virginian slave owner to me, "will hardly earn their salt after they come to the breeding age. They don't come to the field, and you go to the quarters and ask the old nurse what's the matter, and she says, 'Oh, she's not well, master, she's not fit to work, sir.' and what can you do? You have to take her word for it that something or other is the matter with her, and you dare not set her to work. And so she lays up till she feels like taking the air again, and plays the lady at your expense.
One Mississippi slave convinced his master that he was nearly blind and therefore unfit to work. After the Civil War, he was freed, and once free, he proceeded to become one of the best farmers in the area, freedom having miraculously restored his sight. This kind of sabotage did not measurably ease the lives of the slaves, however. The whip flew as often. The overseer's horn blew at every dawn. It was not the kind of sabotage that could have overthrown slavery, but it did undermine it considerably. Most important, it gave the slaves a decided feeling that they were men and women. Of course, the slave's stratagem only succeeded as long as the slave owner could not prove that the work was being deliberately sabotaged. While the slaves may have been tempted to let the master know that they were, in many respects, the masters of those who held them captive, they could not do so. They developed their abilities to be who they weren't to a fine art, and described it in a song. Got one mind for the boss to see, got another mind for what I know is me. They created among themselves a way of life that was different from the one the slave owner wanted them to have. And everything the slave owners taught them, they learned in a way he hadn't intended.
I was never acquainted with a slave who believed that he violated any rule of morality by appropriating to himself anything that belonged to his master, if it was necessary to his comfort, when he took a portion of his master's goods to satisfy his hunger, to keep himself warm, or to gratify his passion for luxurious enjoyment.
A housemaid, who had the reputation of being especially devout, was suspected by her mistress of having stolen from her bureau several trinkets. She was charged with the theft and vociferously denied it. She was watched and the articles discovered, openly displayed on her person as she went to church. She still, on her return, denied having them, was searched and they were found in her pockets. When reproached by her mistress and lectured on the wickedness of lying and stealing, she replied with the confident air of knowing the ground she stood upon, "Don't say I'm wicked. It's all right for us poor colored people to appropriate whatever of the white folks' blessings the Lord puts in our way."
The slave determined right and wrong very easily. Whatever the slave owner considered right was wrong. Whatever he considered wrong was right. For the slave, it was only considered stealing if you took something from a fellow slave. To take from the slave owner was merely to appropriate that which was in actuality yours. It was only through your labor that the slave owner acquired what he had. From the laws and physical force that the slave owners used to maintain slavery, it is obvious that the slaves did not become the puppets their owners would have liked. Laws were made governing every aspect of a slave's life, giving the slave no legal rights and the slave owner all. These laws gave the slave owners control over the bodies of their property, but the slave's mind remained in his possession. And to a certain degree, so did his body. Even though the slaves returned from the fields exhausted at night, they would often sneak off to the woods for church services, singing, and parties, where they would sing and dance away the pain of the day and feel that ecstasy which comes from knowing that one is a human being, not a work animal. White men were hired to patrol the roads and woods surrounding the plantations to catch any slave who might be going to a gathering or trying to escape. These paddy rollers, as they were called by the slaves, had permission to whip any slave they caught.
When the niggers go round singing "Steal Away to Jesus," that means they're going to be a religious meeting that night. The masters before and after freedom didn't like them religious meetings, so us naturally slips off at night, down in the bottoms or somewheres. Sometimes us sing and pray all night.
I remember one night the paddy rollers come when he was having a big meeting in one of the cabins. They had a big wooden log stuffed with mud in the fire. That make a lot of hot coals to use, just as we heard them old man Jiggs and Charlie Dow shovel fire and coals right out the door on them devils. They ran from the fire and we ran from them. Ain't nobody get caught that time.
I remember once we was gonna have a meeting down in the woods near the river. Well, they made me the lookout boy, and when the paddy rollers come down the lane past the church, you see, they was expecting that the niggas was gonna have a meeting that night. Well, sir, they tell me to step out from the woods and let them see me. Well, I does, and the paddy rollers was on horseback come a chasing after me. just a galloping down the lane to beat the band. I was just ahead of them. When they got almost up with me, I ducked into the woods. Of course, the paddy rollers couldn't stop so quick and kept around the bed till there came a screaming and a crying that could make you think hell done bust loose. Them old paddy rollers done rid plumb into a great line of grapevines that the slaves had stretched across the path. And these vines had tripped up the horses and throwed the old paddy rollers off in the bushes. And some done landed mighty hard, cause they was a-limping and a-cussing and a-calling for the slaves to come help them. But them slaves got plenty of sense. After that, old paddy rollers got wise and used to tie up their horses and come creeping through the woods on foot until they find where this meeting was going on. Then they would rush in and start whipping and beating the slaves unmerciful. All this was done to keep you from serving God. And do you know that some of them devils was mean and sinful enough to say, if I catch you in here serving God, I'll beat you. You ain't got no time to serve God. We brought you here to serve us.
One anonymous slave recalled two verses of a song the slaves used to sing about the paddy rollers.
Run, nigga, run, the paddy roll get ya. Run, nigga, run, the paddy roll come. Watch, nigga, watch, the paddy roll trick ya. Watch, nigga, watch, he got a big gun. That was one of the songs the slaves all knowed. Sometimes I wonder if the white man didn't make that song up so us niggas would keep in line.
Generally, the slaves only went out on Saturday nights because they didn't have to rise to the sound of the overseer's horn on Sunday.
Massa Fleming ain't cared how much we dance, but old overseer would raise the devil. Overseer always said, a slave never would work after he'd done dance all night. Used to complain to Massa, and he threatened not to let us dance if we didn't do our work, but he never did stop us. Had to dance or do something. Work in the field all day, and got to have some fun on Saturday nights.
Saturday nights, we slip out the quarters and go to the woods. Was an old cabin about 5 miles away from the house, and us would raise all the ruckus there we wanted to. Used to dance old Jenny down. Who was Jenny? Wasn't nobody but me, I reckon. That's what we gals used to say. Gonna set the flow with Jenny tonight. Sometimes we would say when Mrs. was around, going to see Jenny tonight. And that mean us gonna have a dance. But Mrs. didn't know what we talking about. Sometimes the boys say it too. Can't tell you what they mean. Anyhow, we go to these dances, every gal with her bow and such music. Had two fiddles, two tangerines, two banjos, and two sets of bones. Was a boy named Joe that used to whistle, too. Them devilish boys would get out in the middle of the floor, and me and Jenny and the devil right with them. Set a glass of water on my head, and the boys would bet on it. I had a great big wreath around my neck and a big ribbon bow on each side, and didn't waste a drop of water on none of them.
We had parties, and we'd sing. Massa sleeps in the feather bed, nigger sleeps on the floor. When we get to heaven, there'll be no slaves no more. Then we had a song about this. Rabbit in the briar patch, squirrel in the tree, wish I could go hunting, but I ain't free. Roosters in the hen house, hens in the patch, love to go shooting, but I ain't free.
Saturday only worked half day, and them slaves would show carry on, cause they was gonna celebrate that night. Old Charlie Snipes was the lead man, and he was the biggest cut up in the quarters. We'd all be hoeing potatoes long behind Charlie, and he would be prancing and singing tunes for us to chop by. This the song that Charlie used to sing on Saturdays. Going to the ball, feet dee dee diddle. Who's going to the ball, feet dee dee diddle? Going to wear a red gown, feet dee dee diddle. Wear a red gown, feet dee dee diddle. Going to wear a velvet coat, feet dee dee diddle. And keep it up, putting in words and kicking the clods and step. And sometimes they take it up all over the field just to feet dee dee diddling and stepping high and chopping right in tune. Old overseer was named Barnes, and he would yell and cuss and lash the slaves near him with his cowhide, but he couldn't stop all the slaves from feeling good, because they gonna set the flow that night.
Used to go over to the Saunders place for dancing. Must have been 100 slaves over there, and they always had the best dances. Most times before they danced, they had Dennis to play the banjo. Dennis had a twisted arm, and he couldn't do much work, but he sure could pick that banjo. Gals would put on their spare dress if they had one, and men would put a clean shirt on. Gals always tried to fix up for partying, even if they ain't got nothing but a piece of ribbon to tie in their hair. Most times we wear your shoes to the dance and then take 'em off. Them old hard shoes make too much noise and hurt your feet. couldn't do no stepping in the field shoes. What kind of dances? Well, they wasn't no special name to 'em. There was cutting the pigeon wings that was flipping your arms and legs around and holding your neck stiff like a bird do. Then there was going to the east and going to the west. That was with partners, and sometimes they got to kiss each other. But they stand back and kiss without wrapping no arms round like the young folks do today. And there was calling the figures, and that meant that the fiddler would call the number, and all the couples got to cut that number. Set the flow? That was, well, the couples would do that in turn. They come up and bend over toward each other at the waist, and the woman put her hands on her hips, and the man roll his eyes all around and grin, and they pat the flow with their feet just like they was putting it in place. He used to do that best on dirt floor so the feet could slap down hard against it. Sometimes they would set the flow alone, either a man or a woman. Then they would set a glass of water on their head and see how many kinds of steps they could make without spilling the water. Dancing on the spot was the same thing as set the flow. Almost. Just mean you got to stay in the circle. The fiddler would take a charred corn cob and draw a circle on the flow. Then he called one after the other up and dance in the circle. If your feet touch the edge, you is out. That was just like a cakewalk, because sometimes they bake a cake and give it to the one that did the most steps on the spot. Now, I never did win no cake, but I was pretty good at it just the same, I reckon.
The biggest parties were held, however, at Christmas. There were certain holidays that were celebrated on most plantations, Good Friday, Independence Day, and at the end of cotton chopping season. Christmas, however, was the biggest celebration. Discipline was eased considerably, and the slaves were given 2 or 3 days off, and sometimes they got the entire week between Christmas and New Year's.
Slaves just lived for Christmas to come around, start getting ready the first snowfall, commenced to saving nuts and apples, fixing up party clothes, stitching lace and beads from the big house. General celebrating time, you see, 'cause husbands is coming home and families is getting united. Husbands hurry on home to see their new babies. Everybody happy. Massa always send a keg of whiskey down to the quarters by old Uncle Silas, the house man. Old Joe would drink all he can long the way, but there would be plenty for all. If that don't last, old Massa Shelton gonna bring some more down himself.
The slaves enjoyed Christmas, but it was soon over.
True it was, indeed, that the fun and freedom of Christmas, at which time my master relaxed his front, was generally followed up by a back action, under which he drove and cursed worse than ever. Still, the fun and freedom were fixed facts. We had had them, and he could not help it.
The prayer meetings, the parties, and the holidays did not make being a slave pleasurable. Nothing could do that. But whatever pleasure the slave was able to provide for himself was a remarkable testimony to the ability to retain humanity under the most inhuman conditions. Chapter 6, Emancipation. In April of 1861, the Civil War began, and almost immediately, slaves in the upper southern states of Virginia, Maryland, and Delaware began leaving to join the Northern Army. At first, they were disappointed. President Abraham Lincoln was more intent upon preserving the Union than he was in freeing the slaves. He had ordered all Northern Army commanders to return escaped slaves to their owners. But however many the Union Army returned, twice that number came from another direction to take their place. As far as the slaves were concerned, the Bluecoats, as they called the Northern Army, had come to liberate them, and they weren't going to take no for an answer. Wherever the troops went, the slaves came, and soon, orders or no orders, Army commanders put them to work as laborers and cooks, for which they were paid wages. Most slaves did not have to be convinced to leave Ole Massa. Others did, like the young boy in the following narrative, whose brother, Jeff, had escaped and joined the Yankees. Jeff then came back to get his little brother.
He said, "I am with the Yankees, and I slipped off to come and get you. I have been ducking and dodging for 3 days trying to get here. I want to take you with me. Don't be scared of the Yankees. And even if we should get killed, it won't be much worse than staying here." I was scared of the Yankees, and especially the cavalry, for I had seen troops of horses go by, and they looked so awful and sounded like thunder. Too, Massa Bill had always told me that the Yankees were mean and would kill all the Negroes they could get their hands on. But after I heard what Jeff said, I made up my mind to go. I was still young, less than 20, I know.
The young boy took some food from the big house and met his brother in the woods and traveled until nightfall. The next morning, while they were cooking breakfast, some northern soldiers came.
Some Yankees came by on horses. All the men had their helmets tied under their chins, and the horses' hoofs sounded like thunder as they went running down the road. It nearly scared me to death, and I started to run, but Jeff caught me and said, "Charlie, the Yankees won't hurt you." "Haven't I been with them nearly a year? They are fighting Mars Bill and the other white folks. They don't want to do nothing to us. They will pay us for our work, and if Mars Bill tries to get us after we get among them, he will get his foot into it. For they told me that I didn't have to ever go back to him unless I wanted to." We got to camp early the next morning, just as the Yankees were taking the Negroes out to work. There must have been about 1,000 slaves, and they all had axes, going out to cut wood. One troop of cavalry went in front and another behind. This was to protect the slaves from the rebels. When we came in sight of the advance horsemen, two of them came riding real fast toward us with pistols in their hands. I got scared and jumped behind a tree and wouldn't come out. They hollered to Jeff and said, "Halt, who goes there?" Jeff threw up his hands and said, "A workman of the camp, number 89. By this time one of them was upon me. He said, "Who are you?" I said, "I belong to Mars Bill." "What do you want here then? Didn't your master treat you good?" I said, "Mars Bill treated me all right, but I wanted to be free, and I came with my brother over here to work." All the others had come up about this time, and after talking a little while, they told me to fall in line with my brother and the rest of the workers.
Eventually, blacks were employed as fighting troops in the Union Army, and since so many of them had so recently escaped from slavery, they fought fiercely and well throughout the Civil War. There were also blacks used on the side of the Confederacy. Most were taken along to battle by their masters to be body servants. Most slaves, however, remained on the plantation, for they were the South's agricultural labor force, and if the Confederate troops were going to eat and be clothed, the slaves had to remain on the plantation to do the work. Freedom did not come to most of the slaves until the end of the war in 1865. The Emancipation Proclamation of 1863 only applied to those areas of the South under Union control, which was not much at that time. The president of the Confederacy, Jefferson Davis, thought so little of the Emancipation Proclamation that he issued his own proclamation, which stated that all black people in all northern states were to be considered slaves. The slaves, however, knew nothing of the legal subtleties involved in presidential proclamations. As soon as they heard a rumor that they were declared free, they didn't wait for further confirmation. They freed themselves, whether their owners liked it or not.
"I was a young gal, about 10 years old, and we done heard that Lincoln gonna turn the niggers free. Old missus say there wasn't nothing to it. Then a Yankee soldier told someone in Williamsburg that Lincoln done signed the Emancipation. Was winter time and mighty cold that night, but everybody commenced getting ready to leave. Didn't care nothing about missus. Was going to the Union lines. And all that night the niggers danced and sang right out in the cold. Next morning at daybreak, we all started out with blankets and clothes and pots and pans and chickens piled up on our backs, 'cause missus said we couldn't take no horses or carts. And as the sun came up over the trees, the niggers started to sing, 'Sun, you be here and I'll be gone. Sun, you be here and I'll be gone. Sun, you be here and I'll be gone. Bye-bye, don't grieve after me. Won't give you my place, not for yours. Bye-bye, don't grieve after me. 'Cause you be here and I'll be gone.'"
Grandma used to tell this story to everybody that would listen, and I expect I heard it 100 times. Grandma says she was hired out to the Randolphs during the war. One day while she was weeding corn, another slave, Mamie Tolliver, come up to her and whispered, "Sarah, they tell me that Massa Lincoln done set all his slaves free." Grandma say, "Is that so?" And she dropped her hoe and run all the way to the Thacker's place, 7 miles it was, and run to old missus and looked at her real hard. Then she yelled, "I'm free! Yes, I'm free! Ain't got to work for you no more." Grandma say Mrs. Thacker started boo-hooing and threw her apron over her face and run in the house. Grandma knew it was true then.
Some slave owners moved to Texas with their slaves when it appeared that the South might lose the war. By moving to Texas, they hoped that they might hold on to their slaves a while longer.
"We wasn't there in Texas long when the soldiers marched in to tell us we were free. Seems to me like it was on a Monday morning when they come in. Yes, it was a Monday. They went out to the field and they told them they was free. Marched them out of the fields. They come a-shoutin'. I remembers one woman. She jumped on a barrel and she shouted, She jumped off and she shouted. She jumped back on again and shouted some more. She kept that up for a long time, just jumping on a barrel and back off again.
The news that they were free was the fulfillment of a dream that they had taken to bed each night and risen with each morning. How many times they had tried to imagine what that moment would be like, and now it had come. Some found it hard to believe.
One day, I was out milking the cows. Mr. Dave come down into the field, and he had a paper in his hand. "Listen to me, Tom," he said. "Listen to what I read you." And he read from a paper all about how I was free. "You can't tell how I felt." "You joking me," I says. "No, I ain't," he says. "You're free." "No," says I. "It's a joke." "No," he says. "It's a law that I got to read this paper to you. Now listen while I read it again." But I still wouldn't believe him. "Just go up into the house," says he, "and ask Mrs. Robinson. She'll tell you." So I went. "It's a joke," I says to her. "Did you ever know your master to tell a lie?" she says. "No," I says I. "I ain't." "Well," she says, "the war is over and you're free." By that time, I thought maybe she was telling me what was right. "Mrs. Robinson," says I, "can I go over to see the Smiths? They was a colored family that lived nearby." "Don't you understand?" she says. "You're free. You don't have to ask me what you can do. Run along, child." And so I went. I wanted to find out if they was free, too. I just couldn't take it all in. I couldn't believe that we was all free alike. Was I happy? You can take anything, no matter how good you treat it. It wants to be free. You could treat it good and feed it good and give it everything it seems to want. But you can open up the cage, it's happy.
Most slaves, though, had no difficulty at all believing the news when they heard it.
The news come on a Thursday, and all the slaves been shouting and carrying on till everybody was tired out. I remember the first Sunday of freedom. We was all sitting round, resting and trying to think what freedom meant, and everybody was quiet and peaceful. All at once, old Sister Carrie, who was near about 100, started into talking. "'Tain't no more selling today. Tain't no more hiring today. Tain't no more pulling off shirts today. It's stomp down freedom today. Stomp it down." And when she says stomp it down, all the slaves commenced to shouting with her. "Stomp down freedom today. Stomp it down. Stomp down freedom today." Wasn't no more peace that Sunday. Everybody started in to sing and shout once more. First thing you know, they done made up music to Sister Carrie's stomp song and sang and shouted that song all the rest of the day. Child, that was one glorious time.
I remember hearing my pa say that when somebody came and hollered, "You niggas is free at last," say he just dropped his hoe and said in a queer voice, "Thank God for that." It made old Miss and old Master sick till they stopped eating a week. Pa said old Master and old Miss looked like their stomachs and guts had a lawsuit and their navel was called in for witness. They were so sorry we was free.
Daddy was down to the creek. He jumped right in the water up to his neck. He was so happy he just kept on scooping up handfuls of water and dumping it on his head and yelling, "I's free, I's free, I's free."
Niggers shouting and clapping hands and singing, chilling, running all over the place, beating time and yelling. Everybody happy. Show did some celebrating. Run to the kitchen and shout in the window, "Mammy, don't you cook no more. You's free, you's free." Run to the hen house and shout, "Rooster, don't you crow no more. You's free, you free." Go to the pig pen and tell the pig, "Oh pig, don't you grunt no more. You's free, you's free." Tell the cows, "Oh cow, don't you give no more milk. You's free, you's free." And some smart aleck boy sneaked up under Miss Sarah Ann's window and shouted, "Ain't got to slave no more. We's free, we's free."
The war was over, and when the South surrendered to the North at Appomattox, it was appropriate that there were blacks present to watch the official end of the war and slavery.
General Lee tipped his hat first, and then General Grant tipped his'n. General Lee got off his horse, and General Grant got off his'n. General Lee got on a new uniform with gold braid and lots of buttons, but General Grant got on the old blue coat that's so dirty it looked black. They stood there talking about half an hour, and then they shake hands, and us what was watching know that Lee done give up. Then General Lee tipped his hat, and General Grant tipped his'n, and General Lee rode over to the rebel side, General Grant rode over to our side and the war was over.
But with the end of the war, there were, of course, those slave owners who said nothing to their slaves about the war being over or that they were free.
Guess I was about 15 years old when Master come back from fighting, mean as ever. Never did say nothing about the war, and I didn't know if it was over or not. But one day, Master Bob, his son, was switching me in the woods, playful-like, and he said, "Why don't you strike at me back, Missy? You's free. That's what the war was for, to free the niggas." I took the switch away and beat him hard as I could across the head until it busted. Then I run across the field to some colored folks about 6 miles away. Their names was Foreman, and they was free, sure enough. They told me that was right. They've been free for more than a year. Ain't never been back to that place.
Freedom. One day they had been awakened by the sound of the overseer's horn. The next day they were not. One morning they had gone to the fields, and before the sun set they had left their hoes, their plows, their cotton sacks lying in the furrows. And they put the full meaning of it into one eloquent phrase, which they sang over and over.
Free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, I'm free at last.
Chapter 7, After Emancipation. The glorious feeling of freedom did not last long. Under slavery, the physical needs of the slaves had been supplied, however inadequately. With freedom, they suddenly found themselves in a position where they had to supply their own needs. All were willing and able to do so, but to do so they required land of their own and farm equipment to get started. To be really free, it was necessary that they were able to make a living by themselves. It was necessary that they not have to go to those who had formerly held them as slaves and ask for jobs. There were some members of Congress who were aware of the problem. It was true, they argued, that Negroes could now vote, but the vote alone was not enough. Blacks had to be economically independent from a white South that was built on black slavery and resented black freedom. These congressmen, the radical Republicans as they were called, argued for 40 acres and a mule for every ex-slave. Their arguments were in vain. Freedom did not come to blacks. It merely visited for a while.
The Yankee soldiers give out news of freedom. They were shouting around. I just stood around to see what they was going to do next. Didn't nobody give me nothing. I didn't know what to do next. Didn't nobody give me nothing. I didn't know what to do. Everything going. Tents all gone, no place to stay, and nothing to eat. That was the big freedom to us colored folks. I got hungry and naked and cold many times. I had a good master and thought he always treated me heap better than that. I wanted to go back, but I had no way.
It seemed like it took a long time for freedom to come. Everything just kept on like it was. We heard that lots of slaves was getting land and some mules to set up for themselves. I never knowed any what got land or mules nor nothing.
Freedom turned into another kind of slavery, for many slaves were forced to return to their former plantation and ask old Amasa for a job. The former slave owners were happy, of course, to see the ex-slaves return, for the fields needed plowing and the crops planting. Instead of paying the ex-slaves wages, however, the former slave owners let them work on shares. The plantation owner would provide them with cottonseed, a house, food, farm tools. Once the crop was harvested, he would take half, plus enough crops to cover the cost of the seed, tools, rent, and food that he had let the ex-slave have. Once the owner had deducted his share and the expenses incurred, what was left was the ex-slave's share. Usually that was nothing.
The next bad thing happened to us poor niggers after the war was this. The white folks would pay niggers to lie to the rest of the niggers to get the farming done for nothing. He'd tell us to come on and go with me. A man wants a gang of niggers to do some work, and he'll pay you like money growing on trees. Well, we ain't had no money, and we ain't used to none. So we glad to hear that good news. We just up and bundle up and go with this lying nigger. They carries us by the droves to different parts of Alabama, Arkansas, Missouri. After we got to these places, they would put us all to work, all right on the great big farms. We all light in and work like old horses, thinking how we was making money, but we never did get a cent. We never did get out of our debt. We always get through with fine big crops, and owed the white man more than when we started the crop, and got to stay to pay the debt. It was awful. All over it was like that.
Old Miss and Massa was not mean to us at all until after surrender and we were freed. We did not have a hard time until after we were freed. They got mad at us because we was free, and they let us go without a crumb of anything, and without a penny and nothing but what we had on our backs. We wandered around and around for a long time. Then they hired us to work on halves, and man, we had a hard time then.
Slavery returned in almost every respect except name. Many slaves made plans in case slavery did return.
When us black folks got set free, us and change our names so effing the white folks get together and change their minds and don't let us be free anymore, then they have a hard time finding us.
The names didn't matter, though. They were known by the color of their skin, and they became objects to be kept in their place. A white terrorist group was organized right after the Civil War in 1866 called the Ku Klux Klan. The former slave trader and Confederate General Nathan Bedford Forrest became the head of it. He became one of the main instruments to keep blacks from possessing their freedom.
After us colored folks was considered free and turned loose, the Ku Klux broke out. Some colored people started to farming and gathered old stock. If they got so they made good money and had a good farm, the Ku Klux would come and murder them. Government builded schoolhouse and the Ku Klux went to work and burned them down. They'd go to the jails and take the colored men out and knock their brains out and break their necks and throw them in the river. There was a colored man they'd taken. They'd taken him and destroyed his stuff and him because he was making some money. Hung him on a tree in his front yard, right in front of his cabin.
I come in contact with the Ku Klux. Us left the plantation in 65, and by 68, us was having such an awful time with the Ku Klux. First time they come to my mama's house at midnight, and claimed they were soldiers done come back from the dead. They all dressed up in sheets like the spirit. They groan round and say they had been killed wrongly and come back for justice. One man, he just looked like an ordinary man, but he sprung up about 18 feet high all of a sudden. Another said he's so thirsty he ain't have no water since he been killed at Manassas Junction. He asked for water and he just kept pouring it in. Us think he be a spirit to drink that much water. Of course, he not drinking it. He was pouring it in a big bag under his sheet. My mama never did take up no truck with spirits, so she knowed it was just a man. They tell us what they were going to do if we don't all go back to our masters. Us all agrees, and then they all disappear.
When the Union Army left the South in 1876, after occupying it from the close of the Civil War, political power returned to the former slave owners. Almost immediately, state legislatures began passing laws restricting the movements and activities of blacks. These laws were little different from the laws that were on the books during slavery itself. But instead of calling it slavery, it was called segregation. It was inevitable from the moment the North refused to ensure the freedom of blacks, which had been won with 4 years of bloody fighting.
Many of the bosses, after the freedom, couldn't stand it and went in the house and got a gun and blew out his brains. If Lincoln had lived, he would have separated us like they did the Indians. We would not have been slaughtered, burned, hanged, and killed if we had been put to ourselves and had our own laws. Many a person is now in torment because of this mix-up. God give us a better principle, and we could have had thousands of whites slaughtered, but we didn't after the freedom.
Lincoln got the praise for freeing us, but did he do it? He gave us freedom without giving us a chance to live to ourselves, and we still had to depend on the Southern white man for work, food, and clothing, and he held us out of necessity and want in a state of servitude, but little better than slavery. Lincoln done little for the Negro race, and from a living standpoint, nothing. White folks are not going to do nothing for Negroes except keep them down. Harriet Beecher Stowe, the writer of Uncle Tom's Cabin, did that for her own good. She had her own interest at heart, and I don't like her, Lincoln, or none of that crowd. The Yankees helped free us, so they say, but they let us be put back in slavery again. When I think of slavery, it makes me mad. I do not believe in giving you my story, because with all the promises that have been made, the Negro is still in a bad way in the United States, no matter in what part he lives. It's all the same. Now, you may be all right. There are few white men who are, but the pressure is such from your white friends that you will be compelled to talk against us and give us the cold shoulder when you are around them, even if your heart is right towards us. You are going around to get a story of slavery conditions and the persecutions of Negroes before the Civil War, and the economic conditions concerning them since that war. You should have known before this late date all about that. Are you going to help us? No. You're only helping yourself. You say that my story may be put into a book, that you are from the Federal Writers Project. Well, the Negro will not get anything out of it, no matter where you are from. Harriet Beecher Stowe wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin. I didn't like her book, and I hate her. No matter where you are from, I don't want you to write my story, because the white folks have been and are now and always will be against the Negro.
Been a slave most all my life. So's my kids and so's my wife. I've been working on the Colonel's farm. Ain't been mistreated, ain't done no harm. I'll be a slave. Free.